I know you're gonna dig this.
This is Daunte Beddingfield, host of the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center's award-winning show, The Funk Chronicles, recorded live here at DATV Studios in Dayton, Ohio. Today we have a very special guest with us, Skyping in all the way from Los Angeles, California, Rickey Vincent, author of Funk, The Music, People, and the Rhythm of the One. How are you today, Rickey?
I'm doing great, Daunte. Happy to be here.
Thank you for being with us. Let's start where the story starts here. What's your relationship to Dayton Funk in particular?
Well, I first got a whiff of Dayton Funk jamming all those Ohio Players records back in the day. And I knew that they were one of the top bands of in my whole life. And then it was something special when I heard that the mayor of Dayton gave the Players the key to the city one day. And I was like, whoa, they're actually recognizing the masters of funk. And you know, before you knew it, there was Dive, there was Slave, there was Zapp and Roger. We heard about Heat Wave and all these other bands like Sun and Phazo. And there was just something special about that area, the whole greater Ohio region where Bootsy and Sugarfoot, you know, put a stamp down when the Godfather of Soul, James Brown, did his production. And so you always sort of knew that there was a center of gravity out there as a funk fan, even out here on the West Coast. I'm from the Bay Area with Sly and the Family Stone, put that foundation down, how to put a funk show together. So we was loving it. And then as years went on, it didn't fade. Some of these music scenes, they fade away, and there's people that forget about it. But Dayton folks held it together. And that was built into a Dayton Funk Center and the stuff David Webb is doing. And I was like, you know, this is somebody I can rely on. And then when we lost Marshall Jones, I was like, oh, no, let's see if there's somebody did some proper respect to him. And I was able to track down something that Dayton Funk Center was doing with Marshall Jones when we were doing our tribute to the rock Marshall. Ohio Players on my radio show, The History of Funk with Rickey Vincent. We had to do him properly, and it was good to know y'all doing him properly too. So that's what it's about. It's about you know, recognizing this funk being here forever.
Yes. Real quick, favorite Ohio Player song?
Oh man, there's too many of them. You know, it's like early in the morning, I like Players Ballin'. You know, then I like Worm. You know, then I like Smoke.
I'm about Sweet Sticky Thing.
Then I like, Running from the Devil. You know, then it's all about Jive Turkey. I mean, there's so many and so many ways they put things together. There was a time when Sweet Sticky Thing was the greatest song of all time.
Yes.
You know, so I saturated, soaked them all up. No, I started looking up the cover art models just yes. Part of my journalism to see what had happened to them. And, you know, it was just an amazing story, everything they did as artists, as players, as innovators, and as leaders of a musical movement, Ohio Players.
And can you talk a little bit about the bands that came out of Dayton who shaped funk and the influences that they brought in from other genres of music before them?
Well, see, the thing is about Dayton funk bands and a lot of the great 70s funk bands, they were self-contained. They had as much of a rhythmic guitar rock feel as they had a jazzy horn arrangement, horn feel, as they had strong soul vocals. And it sometimes it's hard to pull all those apart. And then when you talk about songs like Fantastic Voyage, they had a natural affinity for rapping and rhyming.
Yes.
In their funk. Now, it's a subtle thing, but, you know, you can have rap music with funk, but that's not the same as funk with rap music in it.
Right.
And so some of us understood the difference. But it was something special the way it seemed like that was the standard in a funk band, especially a Dayton funk band, that you bring all these elements in there so that the groove is number one. You can take some time and study some great, you know, funk songs like Slave, like Slide by Slave, and pull apart, you know, the horn arrangement, pull apart rack guitar, and yeah, pull apart that bass line, and all the things that are going on. But if you study all of Dayton funk, everybody is putting in a horn arrangement that sounds like they've been listening to Fred Wesley and the JVs. Everybody's throwing some guitars in there that sound like, you know, they've been listening to Curtis Mayfield or Jimi Hendrix.
Or Wes Montgomery.
Other people, yeah. And in the West Coast funk, the big bass, the Larry Graham, you know, and bottom that you know, sort of echoes through Dayton. And so it's beautiful the way they take all these things in and then they make it their own. And I always was impressed or intrigued. I don't know why this is the case, but every Dayton funk band had a top 10 hit was on a different record label. So it was not like the one mogul, Dick Griffey type of George Clinton type of manager that brought in everybody under their umbrella. It's like all these funk bands was doing it on their own and made it on their own. And then you connect the dots and like that funk, that Dayton funk, you know, made it all happen. And so that was a beautiful thing to me to watch, you know, all of this, you know, stuff that was just, it was just live and people made it happen. There's funk bands all over the country and all over the world, but to make it happen, get your records out, put concepts on your album covers, you know, put hit singles together, put interesting original songs together, do the whole thing. So many people knew what they were doing from start to finish. That was a beautiful thing. That's what you got to love about Dayton funk.
I mean, we were the epicenter, there's no question.
Definitely.
Tell us a little bit about the lesser known Dayton funk bands and what they contributed and why they were just as important as the Ohio players and Lakeside.
Well, you know, Dayton, like a lot of Midwestern cities, like a lot of black cities in the 70s, the high school bands were a big thing. Some places had the Battle of the Bands go down, and we had those in the Bay Area. And that was where you honed your chops. You had to be able to perform and get the kids, get your peers, you know, riled up and do a better job than the folks that came before you or after you in the lineup. And you had to bring it. And so you could tell that once these groups got record deals, they had been doing what they were doing for a while. So it wasn't that hard. And some bands, you know, came apart and members of early bands wound up in later bands.
Yeah.
And that's a natural process. So the fact that there's 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 12 bands that are known from Dayton means that there's, you know, 10 more for each one of those that that pushed them,
exactly,
that made them, you know, that opened for them on a set, or they had somebody so talented they had to poach them and take their guitar player and add them to their band. And so it was a whole scene. And that's a natural thing, and that's a beautiful thing if you can tell that story from the grassroots, because 70s funk is about a generation that that story gets missed. It's so easy to do a hip-hop movie. It's so easy to do a soul man movie.
Right.
It's so easy to tell these other stories, but wait a minute, we're the funk generation. And, you know, it may be late, but the funk ain't never late. So the story's finally being told.
I'm sorry, my second question or my next question fell out of my head. Tell us about where you think funk is headed. Well, sorry, let me go back. Tell us what you think happened to funk when we left the 70s and how it morphed and how it influenced the music that's come in the last 30 years.
Well, things got a little bit nasty in the 80s. because times
nasty got good or nasty bad.
Well, that's a loaded word. Okay? Nasty is whatever it needs to be. And, you know, you got people. I was watching the protests over Trump, and they had the woman get up and say, "I'm a nasty woman, and you can't stop me."
That's right.
Like, well, go on. Go on. That was Ashley Judd. I was like, okay, you nasty. I'm rolling. so there's a way to use that, rawness as empowerment, and that's okay. But it can also get manipulated and turned into something dirty that is a dead end. And so it's a balance. And, you know, for a minute, the funk sort of lost the balance and everybody was trying to out-nasty one another. And it sort of inspired people to go down a certain road, which I'm not gonna speak on. It has always been funky, nasty black entertainers, you know, going way back to Blowfly and Dolemite and folks like that, you know, and there's a time and place for them. And there's a time and place where you love having them around. And we got Too Short out here in the Bay. So, you know,
right,
can't say
right.
Nothing. So that's not a thing in itself. But the mainstream started to sort of follow a trend. And so that was a little bit tricky because, to me, the center of the funk is something that's uplifting and positive. And so for a minute, Rick James had the center of the funk in the 80s. And folks was trying to be more like Rick James than maybe Maurice White or Sugarfoot or, yeah, you know, somebody else that was, you know, based in, you know, blues or based in soul or based in, you know, something else like James Brown. So it got a little bit nasty and got a little bit raw. But what that also meant was the beats got raw. That meant the hits were harder. The drum beats were harder. Yeah. The industrial funk technology had come together where, you know, the beats got bigger and bigger and bigger. And I was loving that. I was loving how raw the underground 80s funk was, because it was building on what had happened. And of course, everybody wanted that zap sound.
Yes.
The music got futuristic in the 80s, you know, Planet Rock and stuff like that was crossing over, you know, from hip hop, and Herbie Hancock's Rocket Band made a lot of noise with this industrial sound. Everybody wanted that futuristic thing, but they also wanted some soul in their futuristic sound. And that's where Roger and Zap come in. And, you know, they changed the world, and they need to be recognized for people that, you know, set in motion the sound that other people were trying to follow. And they tried to do this and tried to do that, but, you know, Roger was telling people, we just the blues for the 80s. And this is what we do. And so that was a real important thing, because people getting into futuristic music, the reason you play electronica and electronic dance music, EDM, is it's like you want to sort of meditate on the electronics in your life, in the future sounds, and kind of put a soul in the machine. That's what people have been trying to do ever since the electronic beats came around. They want to
put a soul in the machine
to this robotic environment that they're in. And Roger and Zap at that time explained it to everybody. You still got to have that thump. And everything in Dayton has that thump. Excuse me, I don't know any disco bands from Dayton. I know funk bands from Dayton because they understood how to put that thump up in there. you know, that kind of told people where to go with it. And now people are trying to figure that out. The entire movement of auto-tune was people trying to cheat, do a shortcut version of what Roger had been doing since he was doing the human body stuff in the 70s. So I just give it up. It just all goes back to what Dayton was doing and paving the way. So the nasty music stripped it down, but now people want some real stuff again. They want some real music, some real beats, some real soul, and they get over the hump with this stuff. So it's about time that people not only happy that there's a Dayton Funk Center, they're going to be flocking to it because they're like, well, where's the real deal? There's too much electronics. There's too much rapping. There's too much knucklehead. There's not enough meat on these bones. And well, you want to go, you want to, you know, some people, you go to a, you know, they process, you know, some meat. Well, go to Dayton. They put the meat on that funk right there. That's what we need.
So where, in your opinion, is funk headed now? What's the future of the funk?
This is a, because the funk is already everywhere. Hmm. And part of it is now there's access to the funk bands that are playing all around the world. And if you know where to look, you can find them. They're on their own websites, right? You can find them, a lot of them on iTunes. You got funk bands in Moscow. You got funk bands in the Middle East. You've been had funk bands in Africa ever since James Oh, yeah. Brown went out there in 1968. You got funk bands in Latin America, all around the Pacific. Japan has a whole lineup of dirty dog funk bands. So
really?
People are building on the funk everywhere. So you got the real deal going on, and then you have funk influence bands, these jam bands and rock bands that get funky, and jazz bands. You can't go to a jazz concert without somebody breaking out into a jazz funk fusion jam, that just so they can tell their audience, we've been paying attention, we know where the one is at, we know how to bump it, you know, we'll smooth it out for a good half an hour, but then before you go, just so you know, boom, this is what we do. So the thing is, the funk has sort of oozed into every other style of dance music, a music that can make you move.
Yeah.
It just doesn't get labeled the way it should. If it was, you know, something that came out of some, you know, recognizably, you know, white environment, it would probably get a label everywhere it went. But because the funk, you know, comes from this raw root of the black experience that is really from the black awakening that comes out of the 60s and into the 70s. And that belonged to black folks. Soul Train belonged to black folks, whatever you want to say about it. And that spread around the country and around the world. And people right now in Bolivia are watching Soul Train, trying to figure out those dances, trying to get those fashions down, and trying to, like Lakeside was hitting when they was doing Raid on Soul Train in 1983. People mm-hmm. still trying to figure that stuff out, because that's that hump that gets you going and gets you through it. So the funk is going on. It's, like I said, it's spread everywhere, but it's underground. It's invisible. It's everywhere and nowhere at the same time. And that's all right, because funk is underground. You can't really sell it out. Once you sell it out, the funk is just going to get, you know, hotter on the underground. That's just how it works.
Now, I feel like part of the difficulty with funk being spread out as far as it is, and so much of it being underground, is that in some ways makes it hard to pull together memorabilia for something like a funk center, you know, or some sort of exhibit commemorating the history. What do you feel, how do you feel people should be going about collecting funk memorabilia, or what should people be looking for if they might have something in their basement or their grandparents' attic or something?
If you have people or family that have been, you know, in the entertainment business, and they have, you know, props and things, look for the stuff where they were presenting themselves as larger than life, as somebody that's out, you know, out of the box, really. It was a big deal when I was writing about the funk back in the 90s, and some people just thought the funk bands were just clowns, people wearing silly-looking stuff. And the whole point of the creation of funk bands was a whole bunch of brothers was like, we're not going to be in your box anymore. We're not going to wear the suit. We're not going to wear the uniform of the Negro entertainer any longer. As a matter of fact, we are going to break all the way out. And so it was a real reason why a lot of these bands, you know, folks went interplanetary, and a lot of these people started wearing, you know, leather and Native American looking fashions and things, and saying, we're going to be a tribe. We're going to be somebody that just, we're in our own kind of, we're creating our own civilization.
that you think of LaBelle and P-Funk, obviously.
Exactly. It's a whole different alternate world. Lakeside did that with every album. They came genies. They came pirates. They came, you know, as something different every time, because being in this box of Western civilization, that'll only take you so far. And Black folks have always been futurists. All our music has been, one day we shall be free. You know, let's imagine that future. Black music has always done that. And funk started to put some reality to that fantasy. And so that's the real thing. So when you look around, you can find memorabilia. I mean, it's easy. Somebody used to ask me, what's the difference between soul and funk? I'm like, go back and look at the performance. The soul singers kept their suits on. I mean, they were great. The OJs and the Main Ingredient and them guys, they looked good. And some of them made some bona fide funk records, but they was wearing some tuxedos and some suits. The funk bands took it to another step. And they just came out from under their sheet and did something, you know, on a different level of wild. And so for the most part, you can find, you know, the gear and the equipment of a funk band. And these people, they were just taking it way out there. And that shouldn't be hard to find, because you can find rock bands. And those kids have been doing that since the middle of the 1960s also, since the psychedelic era, which the Bay Area played a role in. You know, when you're looking for that stuff, you can find it if a lot of those artifacts, you know, are coming crazy or coming out the box. Not that you can't come clean. James Brown started, you know, with clean funk, but his band came with dirty, dirty, nasty licks and grooves, and James had to keep up with that and come with his grunts. So there's a whole type of clean funk, and I'm not gonna pretend that's not there. But if you're looking for that Dayton funk artifact, most of the Dayton funk bands, they had a special, you know, out there look they wanted people to know about, and because that said, they are, you know, sort of bigger than the you know, the box of, you know, society that they're put in.
Now we're trying to obviously collect as much funk memorabilia as we can here at the center. Why do you feel it's important to preserve that history, to pull as many of those things as possible together for preservation?
Well, if you read a lot of the music histories, a lot of them will say hip-hop music is good at telling you like it is, but the music before hip hop tells it like you want it to be. A lot of Black music from soul and blues and gospel is always, this is where we want it to be. And hip hop is always telling you, this is how it is. It's like that. And that's the way it is. And funk and Black music in general, and maybe music in general, is something that tunes into, sort of a space, you know, a kind of a zone that you want to be living in, you know, a space where life is perfect, that type of thing. And so great funk music grinds you through all the dirt and drama and still has that idealism, that hope, that next thing that we could be living for. So that's what's beautiful about it. And that's what I look for in the funk. I don't even remember your question, but I like to think about the funk that way.
The question was, why is it important to preserve the memorabilia and keep that memory alive in a tangible way, in one place, if possible?
Because we got to keep looking to the future. We got to keep looking to the future. I mean, we got what we got. And the funk bands were saying things, and Scott Brown writes about this, how the 70s funk was more or less a zenith in the Black middle class and families in the Midwest in particular, and Dayton, Ohio, specifically, there were the means for groups of young brothers and some other folks and sisters to get in there and make these big ensemble bands come together and put all these ingredients together to say something about who they were, where they were, and where they wanted to go. And there's bands jamming all around the country right now, and they're trying figure out, well, what are we really, what are we trying to say? What do we really mean? Well, who should we emulate and stuff like that? And when they finally get past some of the basic education and they want to get to the serious level, that's where they find the, and if they got the courage and they got the skill, they can go to the land of funk and take their whole worldview to another level. That's what it's about.
So what led you, obviously you're very passionate about funk music, what led you to write your book?
Because I was very passionate about funk music. And out here in the Bay Area, the Oakland Coliseum Arena, which is now the Oracle, where the Golden State Warriors play their basketball, for Ohio folks, we kind of, y'all understand what we do out here. I'll just leave it at that. but that arena has a legacy of great concerts, legendary concerts. So that's where Earth, Wind & Fire's big productions were. Any fan of Marvin Gaye knows Marvin Gaye Live, where he's singing Distant Lover and all the
girls go,
Distant Lover. That was recorded at the Oakland Coliseum Arena. Those are Oaktown girls that are doing all that screaming. Parliament Funkadelic landed the mothership at the Oakland Coliseum Arena. That's the show that's recorded on the Parliament Live album. So there was a lot going on there. So all the bands came out to that arena at that time. So I saw Brass Construction and Rolls Royce and Brick, and I saw Slave and Lakeside and Zapp and Roger and Cameo and all these bands. And with the show as big as it was going to be. And so at that time I started, I was looking, and I wasn't a musicologist. I was just a kid in high school who was collecting records. I was just a crate digger. But I could tell then that they had advanced horn sections that understood arrangements and solos. They had guitarists that knew how to rock and hit that Jimmy Nolan rhythm shank thing that the James Brown band could always do. And they had soul singers that knew how to sing, not just sing, but sang. And then they had a show. They put a show together. And I said, wait a minute. And all these ingredients that I'm told are parts of the black music tradition together. And when I started to figure that out, I was like, okay, well, where's the documentary? Where's the, the big PBS documentary on what these great funk bands are doing? And there was next to nothing that really was explaining that. There was one Ebony magazine cover story back in 1978 that talked about the great funk bands. And Rufus and Chaka Khan and Bootsy Collins and some other folks were on the cover of that magazine. And it said what everybody knew, that these funk bands was taking over the world. And disco was just trying to ride that and eventually kind of took it over. But, so I was looking at sort of the ethnomusicology of what funk bands were up to as a high school kid. And then, I got to college and had to grind through it. But before I knew it, I was in college radio and these demos, 12-inch singles were coming through to the college radio record bin, and these are rap groups that were sampling the Fatback Band and sampling Mass Production and sampling, all this funk. And people are asking me, Rick, hey, funk dude, where from? Well, where does that sample come from? What is this, Two Live Crew? Well, why are they sampling this? And boom, 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 boom. Everybody wanted to sample that funk, and they weren't sampling blues, they weren't sampling gospel, they weren't sampling jazz, they weren't sampling rock, they were sampling the funk. And it was clear that to me that the funk had changed the world, that people had tried to sort of suppress it and keep it from happening, and it bubbled up once again in the 80s in the form of the hip-hop generation building on it. And I was saying, well, somebody got to tell this story. I kept waiting for somebody to tell that story. Where's that funk, tale going to come from? And nobody had done it. And I just kept on writing and kept on putting some ideas together. And then, you know, when you're in school, you got to write about something. And I was like, oh, you have to have a culminating writing project. What do you care about the most? Well, let's see. I care about the funk. Let me start writing about that. Mm-hmm. And I had a few good teachers who said, you know, be free and do it the way you want to do it. And so that was helpful. And so I did some as an undergrad, and I went to San Francisco State, which is ground zero for ethnic studies. That's where the Third World College began. That's where ethnic studies began. And they have a black studies there. I think it's called Africana studies. So they get deeper into everything, you know, that is African in the African-American life. And I went there and I said, I'm doing the funk. And they said, well, we don't understand that, but we understand that it's a part of black life. And that was serious at that time. I mean, now, only now, is funk getting recognized as a fundamental aspect of African-American life and culture. Yes. And most of us are old enough to know when funk was just considered something not even worth having a conversation about in polite black society.
Yep.
People just too silly. It was just too, you know, it was too dirty. You know, but now folks know it's the time is now. Time is real. Let's get to the real. And the funk has always been there with the real.
How would you say that bands like Sly and the Family Stone, The Meters, Average White Band, Tower of Power, Kool and the Gang, bands like that, how would you say that they ended up influencing bands that kind of built on that and then went outward, like the Red Hot Chili Peppers?
Well, if you're going to study music, right, if you're going to play a, you know, two-chord rock tune and figure it out, after a while, you're like, well, that was fun. What's the next level? You know, if you're going to put some, you know, horn arrangement that sounds like something from Stax or something from Motown, like, okay, that was fun. Okay, now what's the next level? Mm-hmm. And you might try to, arrange something like Weather Report or some fusion band, and that might be a lot of work, but you might find yourself, not on the dance floor anymore. So you're like, okay, so what? How do I get this on the one, but it works the things that need to be worked to make the music, really, really hit? And those bands that you mentioned, the Meters and Kool and the Gang and those folks, they do very complex work that sounds simple because it sounds pure. You can feel it in a natural way. It comes right at you.
Yeah.
So I think a musician builds their way up to getting to the, you know, something that is, it has a raw feel, but it is built on some good, strong fundamentals. And for a good long time, you know, you had to put arrangements in your music. You had to put layers in your music. You'd have to do a song that had a clavinet and an organ and electric piano. Yep. All doing something at the same time as the rest of a full band with horns. You know, some being arranged and some freestyling. So you had all kinds of things to do, but it made it bigger, made it better. And so when I wrote the funk book and I was over there at the Afrocentric San Francisco State, you know, I was able to see it all as a African way of making music. Mm-hmm. A drum circle, your New Orleans second line, they always got bigger. Everybody was welcome. Everyone's rhythm contributes to the overall rhythm of the experience. So you make your funk band bigger and bigger because if the music's on the one, everything will fit. So funk bands are cool. They allowed for things to get bigger and bigger. And there's a way to do it right. And sometimes it just became a big swamp. That's what people said about some of those Miles Davis shows, that they just became a big swamp. But you can put it all together and let people work together and still be free and have their free expression. And that's what all those, especially those early grooving bands like Mandrill and Charles Wright and the Watts 103rd Street Band.
Oh, man, yeah.
Sly and the Family Stone, like you mentioned. And, and the Meters and the people the Meters played with back then. It was about that pocket. And that was the other thing. the bands could groove as long as they wanted, but then they also knew they had to make a 3.5 minute radio single.
Right.
Right. And that was kind of the give and take. And some people did that well. Some people, it took a minute. You know, I listened to the Pain album by the Ohio Players. There's no 3 minute single on that record.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's just a deep pocket that they want you to get into. And that was cool. But then they built their craft into some songs that, you know, that hit. And then, of course, Funky Worm changed the entire world of music for the next 20, 30 years. Mm-hmm. So it was a give and take. But these bands, first thing they did was they grooved together. And then they arranged for the radio. And they kind of had to, I don't want to say dumb it down, but they kept it, you know, as basic as they could so that the radio audience would hear it.
So tell us about your album.
The Rickey Vincent CD.
Yes.
Fool for the Funk, this thing.
P-H-O-O-L for those at home.
Fool for the Funk. It began as a project with a local producer out here, Phil Jones. He's worked with some other guys and had some of the, you know, funk legends on his records before. And he said, Rick, it's your turn. And the first thing I thought, I would take some of my radio interviews and just mash them up, you know, in a funky way. And I went to Phil Jones' spot, the Funky Instrumentalist, PTFI, that's what we call him on the record. And his beats were so heavy and strong, a big slapping Bay Area funk. I was like, some of them I did. I said, well, let me put my Junie Morrison interview on that beat right there. Mm-hmm. Don't give it to nobody else. That's for me. Let me take this James Brown interview that I did back in 1993, right after he got out of jail and he was mad about everything. And he did a great interview. And I didn't know what to do with it. And, you know, we sort of locked it down and made a song out of the interview. And that's how it began. But then he would play me some other beats. And I was like, oh, that one, I need to just act a fool on that one. Let me just call this one Go Wiggle and just get groovalistic on it and start to have some fun. You can't just be too serious about it. That's like Chuck D and Flavor Flav. Who's ever listened to an entire Chuck D album? No. Who's ever listened to an entire Flavor Flav album? No, but
I'm not even sure Flavor Flav has listened to an entire Flavor Flav album.
And it works. So that's where I was at. And so there's some education, some sort of loops in there. And then we just cut loose. And I have some guest people. Fred Wesley got in there and did things. And Dawn Silva lives out here. She did some stuff with me on a track we call Deep Sea Divers. It kind of celebrates the Soul Sisters and the Funk, who was swimming a deeper level of the ocean than the rest of us.
Right.
So, you know, it's a lot of fun. It's a high-quality production. It's on iTunes. You can check it out. And, you know, some people call it, you know, a funk lesson, and I think that's what I do all the time. And I call it a funk celebration. But it's definitely, something that I think people will enjoy. And the funk masters have certified it. You know, Bootsy has talked about it. He said it's overdue, because some stuff in there, and with the, you know, it celebrates him and a lot of the other funk giants, because they're able to, you know, put you in another place, and so I love going to the world of funk, to the land of funk, and taking people there, and keeping them there.
So
as long as I can.
Oh, sorry. So tell folks one more time where they can get your CD and also where they can get your books.
Okay, Fool for the Funk. It's available on iTunes. The disc, this one that opens up and everything, has all the artwork. CD Baby, you can buy it from CD Baby. You can also order it through Amazon.com. There's some at DustyGroove.com. I'm a crate digger. There's a lot of international funk compilations on dustygroove.com.
That's a great website. That's a great resource for funk lovers.
And so my record is up there, the Rickey Vincent Fool for the Funk, and it gets all the good reviews. When people hear it, the funk fans, you know, are all about it because it celebrates their world, and it's a high quality production. And I'm not going to put something that ain't that funky on my record. I've been too deep in it. And, you know, it took a minute being a radio guy to realize, wait a minute, I've been listening to good funk for 40 years, longer than that. So maybe I know what's up. This book is still in print. I use it for my class. Other people use it. Funk, the music, the people, and the rhythm of the one with George Clinton's introduction from way back then. And it came out in 1996, and I'm actually glad I haven't touched it because it has a funky 90s language to it. And I'm developing a newer edition to maybe add a new, you know, kind of opening to it. But it stands the test of time because that was when, you know, the hip hop sampling and everybody wants some funk. And, you know, this is why everybody wants some funk. And that's what it delves into those questions. And it delves into it with a funk language, a funk approach. And I'm very concerned about that. You don't just need to be an outsider with any form of black culture. You don't want to just sound like an outsider to it. If you're not knee deep in it, don't bother me with it. You know, you got to get into it. So that's how I feel about it. And so, like I said, it's stuck around. It's still in print, and that means a lot because black music books don't last very long. You can kind of count on one hand the great black music books that stay in print.
That's true. I never thought about that.
You know, you got Blues People by Leroy Jones. Mm-hmm. You got a small smattering of soul music books that stay around in print or get reprinted. There's a good number of hip-hop books, standard hip-hop books, and a couple of jazz books, but they usually come and go.
Yeah,
but
a lot of the great books about jazz I know are out of print.
Yeah, and you know, part of that is just the messed up part of the industry, and is those things spoke to a certain time and place. But for some reason, the funk, it never fades out. As Sly said, the funk can sit and sit and never go sour. So people still want it. Got that funky power. So these are ways to get it and to keep it moving. It's not just an artifact from back in the thing for you to move forward with your own funky thing.
Now, before we go, I feel like I would be remiss if I didn't get into Cincinnati a little bit. How do you feel? How do you feel our brothers from down the road in Cincinnati kind of fit into the history of funk and what made it great? People like the Isley Brothers and Bootsy.
Well, that's an easy take because, again, if you read a lot of sort of the historiography of, you know, African-American cultural expression, you'll find a lot of documentation deals with the places where the music was produced. Mm-hmm. And a lot of soul music, they talk about Muscle Shoals in Alabama, and they talk about, you know, Memphis and Detroit. So if you're going to talk about funk, where's ground zero but where James Brown recorded he recorded a lot of it on the road, but his headquarters, right, for developing that funk was in Cincinnati, Ohio. And Bootsy and Catfish and the characters that he was rolling with, and Frankie Cash and folks like that, they were all in that orbit. They were all around King Records. They went to hang out and just be in the lobby and just be there and soak it up and learn from the elders and be ready when they can get in and do a little stint here and there. And Cincinnati, so in terms of the funk legacy, specifically for James Brown and King Records, that on its own stands sturdy, you know, as a lighthouse, as a beacon for where you can say an important spark for the funk legend to go. And I believe that story has yet to be told properly. I do believe that the King Records offices need to be rebuilt like the Stax Museum was rebuilt from the ground up. It was an empty lot, the Stax Museum, and they said, you know, it's too important, and you know, it's too relevant, and let's just reconstruct the whole thing. And that needs to happen at King Records. It needs to be done right. And Cincinnati civic leaders, you know, they're down for the funk. Bootsy Collins just got a street named after him. Come on. That's a beautiful thing. He's up there with the Cincinnati Bengals, you know, he's almost their mascot, the way the community has embraced Bootsy and what he's about. And you know, the city is honored to have a funk master, you know, in their midst. It's, and that's a beautiful thing. So I love the way Cincinnati has accepted, relatively speaking, relative to other cities, you know, the way Cincinnati has accepted its funk legacy and given it some appreciation. It'd be nice to have some institutional appreciation, yes, as well. But that's, you know, it's a good start that they're not afraid of their own funk. And y'all have to understand, fear of funk is a big deal. It's a real issue in the Black experience. One of the first pages of the funk book, I quote Toni Morrison talking about how the funk was something that had to be disposed of in the characters in the Bluest Eye. It was like, we can't let that funk be there. We can't let our real, you know, dirtiness be exposed. But once you understand that and accept that that's who we are, then you can build, you know, something beautiful from that. So I love the way Cincinnati, the city, recognizes these funk people, and that deserves to be told as part of a very important funk history, and then we can build on that. And, you know, Southern Ohio is right there across that Mason-Dixon line, so it has historically been a place where people jump that river and go, hey! You know, and so there's a part of that legacy right there, and that you shouldn't be ashamed of that. We should be celebrating that.
And, you know, something a lot of people don't know, in terms of what gave to funk and in terms of what gave to all of music, without Cincinnati, we wouldn't have Jimi Hendrix. O'Kelly Isley discovered Jimi Hendrix in a record store in Cincinnati. He was homeless. He took him home with him, and a lot of people don't know that he got his start with the Isley Brothers. There's some recordings from the mid-60s with Jimmy playing blues guitar behind, you know, Ron Isley singing. And then he went out and did his own thing, and that fed back, because when you listen to things like Voyage from Atlantis, when you listen to Who's That Lady, you hear Ernie and what he picked up on guitar from Jimmy.
See, that's a story that is completely undertold. Ernie's legacy in the music is completely undertold.
Oh, and yeah.
Folks are still just figuring out Jimmy's relationship to music. But Ernie was the number one translator of the Jimmy sound, yeah, into Black music. Other people translated the Jimmy feel and the Jimmy look and the Jimmy attitude of, you know, I'm a free thinking Black man. You know, a lot of P-Funk, those guys lived like Jimmy, but Ernie Isley is the person that explained it to Black radio, to the Black music establishment. Mm-hmm. This is what Jimi Hendrix music means to us. And after Jimmy, every funk band had to have a lead guitarist, not a rhythm guitarist, a lead guitarist. But a lot of that, the heavy lifting was done by Ernie to let Black bands know, this is how you do it. This is how you work with it. This is how you take the freedom that Jimmy told us about and make it something that we can all enjoy and celebrate. So Ernie Isley, and he's still around, and his story needs to be told, because he's one of the most important innovators in what we know and love as funk, and that important connection to the Jimi Hendrix line that I'm glad you mentioned that stuff, because Jimmy was broke as a joke, and it was his relationship to Black artists and entertainers that made him who he was before he got discovered out there in 1966 in Harlem.
Well, Mr. Vincent, we've covered a lot of ground today. I think it's time for us to wrap. I want to thank you for being with us this time, and hopefully we can talk again soon.
I'm happy to do it. Whatever it takes to help the funk along, you know, it's just, that's my life's blood. It keeps me going. So I'm just ready to rock. So thanks for the opportunity, and much respect for what y'all are doing out there, Dayton Funk Center.
Thank you, sir. And this is Daunte Beddingfield for the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center's Funk Chronicles. We'll see you next time, and remember, don't fake the funk.
Enough for that head bobbing music. This is booty bobbing music. Ooh, pressure drop. Are we on? Okay, Mr. Brown, Mr. Brown, Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Talking with Cornel West, the one and only intellectual genius master of black.